Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 27th March, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 17. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, US expels 60 Russians, shuts consulate in Seattle. So, US has expelled 60 Russian officials and has ordered the closure of consulate in Seattle of Russia because of its close proximity to one of its submarine bases and Boeing as such. So that is why they have been asked to leave. 48 of these were posted at the Russian embassy and 12 were on at the Russian mission to UN in New York. So this has been announced to these 60 officials, and also the consulate in Seattle has been asked to shut down. The officials and their families have been given 7 days to leave the US. So the US President Donald Trump has also stated that this is in response to Russia's use of military grade chemical weapons on the soil of United Kingdom. So, US is now supporting its allies and is taking action against Russia, reducing Russia's ability to spy on Americans and conduct such covert operations. He says that Russia threatens America's national security. So, you can see even allies of US have decided to expel Russian officials. So, UK has expelled 23, Ukraine, Canada, even these European countries as such have expelled Russian officials, diplomats as such. Then next is IAS inspired groups trying for JNK's toehold. So this is a news coming forth. The police is investigating this matter and it has come to the notice that Islamic State JNK and Al-Qaeda motivated organizations are now recruiting people in Kashmir Valley, though many are having recruits in single digit, but they are making desperate attempts. And they are said to be in touch with the handlers in Afghanistan and Syria. They are planning to widen their base here. So it is said that Hariat in Jammu and Kashmir, it has become irrelevant now because it has not been able to solve the Kashmir problem. And also Pakistan is having its own monopoly over militancy here. So now these other terrorist organizations are gaining foothold in Kashmir Valley, which is a matter of concern and has been raised as such. Then next is Supreme Court to examine polygamy in Muslim marriages. So we had seen in 2017, in August 2017, that the Supreme Court had passed a landmark judgment in which it had called instant triple talaq illegal. So instant triple talaq has already been pronounced illegal. It is not allowed under the Supreme Court order as such, Supreme Court verdict. And now it is looking at other such provisions which are there. So, constitutional validity of other prevalent practices with respect to Muslim marriages like polygamy, nikah halala, nikah muta and nikah misya are being looked into by the Supreme Court now. So, the Supreme Court bench headed by CJI, Justice Deepak Mishra, is looking into this matter. It has issued notice to the central government and law ministry on these bunch of petitions which have been challenging these practices. They are called to be degrading to the position of women as such in the religion. So this is a point put forth. The bench has also agreed to set up a 5-judge constitutional bench to look into this matter. So whether these Muslim personal law as such goes against the provisions of the constitution or not will be analyzed. Instant triple talaq was also said to be undermining women's rights. So it has been struck down. Also after that, the present government, we have seen it initiated a law, Muslim Women Protection of Rights, but then that law is already what has been called triple talaq has already been called illegal, but then it is making, the bill is making triple talaq an offense with a jail term. So many have criticized it, saying there's no need for a jail term in such a case because anyway the talaq becomes illegal after the Supreme Court verdict. So this is there. So, polygamy, you should know, in this Muslim personal law, a man is allowed to marry up to 4 wives. So, this treats women, in the petition, has been claimed as an object of desire for women and as an object possessed by men. So, this is the point put forth regarding polygamy too, that polygamy should be, you know, as such declared illegal again, because for other religions, polygamy is not allowed, but under Muslim personal law, it prevails. So here you can see this is discussed. So the law allows man to have multiple wives by way of polygamy, but the same permission is not extended to Muslim women. So their polygamy is proposed to be struck down. So even other aspects which are there, like nikah halala. So nikah halala means a Muslim woman cannot marry the person who has divorced her again. The man who has divorced her, in between there should be a marriage which has been consummated. Means she should be married to someone else and has had intercourse with him. And after that, when she's divorced with that husband, she can marry the previous husband as such. So nikah halala as such is done. So this is actually a strict provision in Islam in which a Muslim woman as such once divorced. So divorce is also triple talaq. Instant triple talaq is against the spirit of Islam because talaq is not supposed to take place instantly in one go. So triple talaq in Islam is also that in between each talaq being pronounced, there's a time given to come together. So resolving differences. So this triple talaq practice, which had been initiated, is against the spirit of Islam too and has been rightly struck down by the Supreme Court. And nikah halala is again a practice which is making it difficult that two people who have been divorced, they should not come back together again. So again, nikah halala is something which is a middle way found so that a woman is made to marry another man so that she can marry her previous husband. So of course, nikah halala is not the true essence of Islam. That is not the way Islam is supposed to be. That practice has supposed to be done, but then it is done. So this is also proposed to be declared illegal, which is correct. Also, nikah muta. So this is a marriage which is called pleasure marriage, a temporary marriage contract. So in this, the duration of the marriage and mehr is pre-decided. So again, a temporary marriage is not also within the spirit of Islam. So this is also proposed to be declared unconstitutional. And nikah misyar, which is a practice in which the husband renounces several marital rights to the woman. So rights like living together, the wife's rights to housing and maintenance, and also husband's right to homekeeping and access, all these are denied. So this limited form of marriage, nikah misyar, again is proposed to be declared unconstitutional by the various petitions which have been filed before the Supreme Court. Then next is High Court issues notice to Gujarat Center on deaths of 184 lions. So there are 184 lions who have died in the state of Gujarat. We had seen this news earlier too. So now High Court of Gujarat has taken suo motu cognizance of this report, news report, which the Gujarat government itself disclosed in the assembly, that 184 lions as such, including lionesses and cubs, have died in 2016 and 2017, with 32 of them dying of unnatural causes. So now it has asked the Gujarat government to, and also the union government to, explain regarding this matter. Gujarat is said to be the only home to lions in Asia. And according to 2015 census, there were 523 lions in Gujarat. And now we are seeing various deaths, including unnatural deaths, which the government itself stated in the assembly were due to road accidents, railway tracks passing through forest areas, as well as wells with damaged or no parapets. No walls as such. So this is resulting in various deaths of lions, including even electric fences around agricultural lands. So this is the point being put forth. The government has already stated in the assembly too that they will take steps. Open wells in forests will be, repaired with parapets. Fencing at railway tracks would take place. Also, speed breakers on public roads passing through gate sanctuary would be built. So this is the issue of lion deaths here in Gujarat. The figures are given here, you can see. Then next is summer of discontent. Water crisis looms in Gujarat. So summer has just set in, but it is seen that Gujarat is already facing a water shortage. So the main water sources for Gujarat are the Narmada Dam and other dams here, dozens of other dams and reservoirs, and they're going dry. So crisis has been seen even despite last monsoon being sufficient. So Narmada water has already been stopped for irrigation from March 15, 2018. Even state reserve police personnel have been deployed along the canals to stop farmers from taking water illegally from Narmada canals. Even various villages, it is said around 4,000 out of 18,000 villages in Gujarat are already facing a severe crisis. The sources of water have either gone dry or about to dry. So even the water-starved and drought-prone region of Gujarat, which is the Saurashtra, Kutch, and Northern Gujarat regions, are suffering drastically because Narmada, which is the main source of water for them, has being seen to be insufficient. So even water level here in Sardar Sarovar Dam of Narmada is at about 105 meters, which is less than 50% of dam's average level. So that is why it is seen to be a severe crisis here. In all, there are 203 other dams and reservoirs in Gujarat, but the water level is less than 40% for them, and it is expected they will dry up rapidly as summer peaks up. So this crisis, it is also stated, is because the weak monsoon in Narmada catchment areas in Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat resulted in water in Narmada being collected as just 45% of the sanctioned supply under Narmada tribunal to Gujarat. So this is being stated as the reason. So here you can see the facts or figures are provided. Then next is, PNW begins replacing faulty A320 NEO engines in India. So we have seen Pratt & Whitney, which is an aircraft engine manufacturer from USA. This had its engines supplied to Airbus. The Airbus engines provided to both Indigo and GoAir aircrafts. So these engines have been grounded by Directorate General of Civil Aviation in March, few days back. So we have seen that these were because they were not able to successfully pass the test. So as such, it has been asked to that these engines need to be replaced, and Pratt & Whitney has stated they will start replacing the engines. Aircraft with single engine failures will be first refitted with new engines, and after that the double engine faults will also be repaired. So the replacement engines will be delivered periodically, has been assured by Pratt & Whitney now. So here you can see the details given of this engine failures. So 14 planes had been grounded in India so far by the regulator, that is Directorate General of Civil Aviation. Then next is news about Tagore's song Confusing. So there was this news that a new Tagore song has been unearthed, and this is the name of this poem was "There are numerous strings in a lute." So this actually is said to be incorrect information as such by an eminent writer and scholar on Tagore's work from West Bengal, Mr. Sankha Ghosh. So Mr. Ghosh says that this poem, "There are numerous strings in a lute," is a song, has a tune, and is set in Western classical music tradition by Tagore himself. So this is being traced down to Tagore is great news, but then this is not a new poem, because this poem was found for the first time as such in 1918 when it was published in a book of poems called Crossings. So this is a poem in that 1918 collection. It has been performed in various Christian missionary schools as a prayer song too. But then what was not known was that it was composed by Tagore. So this is a new information. The song as such is not new, has been clarified by Mr. Ghosh. Then next is, avoid killing civilians, forces in Jammu and Kashmir. So forces in Jammu and Kashmir have been told by the Home Ministry that they should avoid killing civilians as such at all costs. So the army, central armed police forces, the state police forces have been instructed so, because it is seen that tourism, which has taken a massive hit in the last 2 years because of an increase in encounters and protests and firings in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So the situation in Kashmir Valley has been fragile since July 2016 when the Hizbul Mujahideen commander Burhan Wani and two others were killed in an encounter. So then, yes, since then we have seen violent protests, and the peace and business in Jammu and Kashmir has been affected, especially tourism. And now the Home Ministry has cautioned security forces and asked it to avoid civilian killings. Then next is, India-China plan FTA breakthrough. So Commerce Minister Suresh Prabhu and his Chinese counterpart met for first high-level contact between India and China as a run-up to the meeting which would take place between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Xi Jinping in the SCO summit in June. So this was there in news on 26th also. So this meeting which took place between the ministers, commerce ministers as such, was part of the 11th meeting of the India-China Joint Group on Economic Relations, Trade, Science and Technology. So it has been said that an FTA has been negotiated between India and China. The negotiations would start soon. And also, it is said that bilateral trade between the two nations in 2017 reached $84.4 billion, a 20.3% high. As such, it is a record high. China's imports from India also increased, is a significant point, because we have a huge trade deficit with China. So 40% increase in China's imports from India. Also, this will help in easing the trade imbalance, which is about $50 billion. So it's a huge imbalance, and it remains to be the most important issue to be addressed. China is also India's largest trading partner as such. So India has also become one of the most important overseas investment destinations for Chinese companies too. So this is also a welcome initiative. So there are, you know, steps being taken to promote India's exports to China so that the trade imbalance can be addressed. And also special working group to draw a roadmap for two-way trade is being looked into. So here you can see the trade with China, the top exports to China: cotton, copper, organic chemicals, and the top imports are also shown here. Imports from China of electrical machinery, fertilizers, organic chemicals. So we have a huge trade deficit. Exports are much low compared to the imports. So a marginal drop in trade deficit took place presently, but that's not sufficient. The trade deficit is quite high. Then next is, China says Doklam is in its territory. So China has reiterated now that Doklam is part of its territory, and the military standoff in the area is which took place in last year between India and China has been kept behind. The two sides are looking forward to new round of engagement as such. So this is the India's ambassador to China also said, thanks to our concerted efforts, our diplomatic efforts and wisdom, we resolve the Doklam standoff issue. And the foreign minister of China also said that Indian and Chinese leaders demonstrated strategic vision in tackling the crisis. But still, China continues to claim that Doklam belongs to China. So this is the status. Then next is, US-India hold naval training. So India's Navy, Indian Navy's Talwar class frigate INS Tarkash carried out a greeting and training exercise with US Navy, the USS Theodore Roosevelt, aircraft carrier of US, and also guided missile destroyer USS Preble. The ships took part in this naval training exercise in which the personnel from both sides practiced working together and initiated strengthening their crew's ship handling. So these drills in communication and navigation were undertaken here between Indian and US naval frigates. Then next is, Saudi forces down 3 Houthi-fired missiles as Yemen war escalates. So we've been seeing that the war in Yemen has escalated. The Houthi rebels here in Yemen are actually targeting Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia and Iran are the regional enemies as such. They have a traditional history of being Shia-dominated and Sunni-dominated. As such, Iran being Shia-dominated and Saudi Arabia being Sunni-dominated, they have been in conflict. Houthi rebels, Houthi, which is a Shia rebel group, again, is said to be supported by Iran. And Houthi rebels have presently, and Saudi Arabia actually intervened in Yemen in 2015. It initiated a joint action in Yemen to clamp down on the Houthi movement. So even UN considers this as the world's most urgent humanitarian crisis, and now Houthi rebels have actually fired missiles in Saudi Arabia, which Saudi Arabia has destroyed as such. So they said, we shot down 3 missiles over Riyadh, but even the debris which fell resulted in deaths of 3 civilians. And Houthi has threatened that they would have more missiles as such bombed on the country. So as long as Saudi Arabia does not stop intervening in Yemen and the Yemen war as such, the attacks would continue as a threat given by Houthi rebels. So here you can see. So this is Yemen, a neighbor of Saudi Arabia, where the Houthi rebels have gained control in various regions, and a coalition headed by Saudi Arabia is fighting against them, bombing this Yemen region. And the Saudi coalition comprises of Kuwait, Bahrain, UAE, Egypt, Jordan, Morocco, Sudan, Malaysia, Senegal, and is also supported by Western powers like US, UK, France, Turkey, Belgium, etc. And the opposite side, the Shia group, is whom the Houthi rebels are supported by whom? They are Iran, China, and Russia. So this is the crisis going on here in Yemen too. It's been 3 years since Saudi Arabia intervened here, and the war continues to escalate. Then next is Malaysia proposes 10 years in jail for fake news. So the Malaysian government has proposed a new legislation to outlaw fake news. So it has proposed 10 years jail term for offenders, and as such it has been criticized because it is said general elections are due in Malaysia and the government is trying to crack down on dissenters. So Malaysian Prime Minister Najib Razak is actually accused in a multi-billion corruption scandal. So this, and the rights activists feel that this new law on fake news will be used to criminalize news reports and critical opinions on government misconduct. So it's not just 10-year jail term, but also fine up to 50,000 ringgits, around $1,28,000, or both can be imposed on those who publish fake news. So fake news is also defined as any news, information, data, report which is wholly or partly false, whether in the form of features, visuals, audio recordings, or any other form. So all mediums are covered, and also it extends to foreigners outside Malaysia as long as Malaysia or its citizens are affected. So this is a draconian law which is being proposed by Malaysian government. Even US and other countries are also investigating allegations of this cross-border embezzlement and money laundering which has taken place in this scam in which the Prime Minister is involved. So the US Justice Department has also said that at least $4.5 billion was stolen from this one MDB. So this is the entire money trail also in this case, you can see. So there were these state-owned companies and their subsidiaries from which financial transactions took place, which eventually went to the Prime Minister Najib Razak's accounts. And also money came in from British Virgin Island Company, that also routed through various companies. So through intermediaries, it finally went into Najib's account. Even it is said Saudi royal family members sent money. So this is claimed to be legal personal donation, and the Attorney General of Malaysia says that much of this money was returned back as such. So this is a whole scandal which has come forth. And in this investigation, because of this, mainly it is said this fake news legislation has been proposed. Then next is government to borrow 2.88 lakh crore in H1, 48% of financial year 2019 budget goal. So it is said that in the first half of the financial year 2018-19, from April to September period as such, the government would borrow 2.88 lakh crore rupees. So this is also 47.56% of the budgeted gross borrowings. So earlier too, it was around 3.72 lakh crores which the government had borrowed in the present 2017-18 financial year. So it is said the government would come up with inflation index bonds linked to CPI or retail inflation as such, which would be sold. Also government securities, G-Secs, of 1 to 4 year duration would be introduced. So this borrowing through government securities would also take place, which would be used to fund fiscal deficit, which will be of 3.3% of GDP. So this fiscal deficit will be funded through this borrowing. Also, government is said to be withdrawing up to rupees 1 lakh crore from National Small Saving Fund to fund the fiscal deficit. So this actually will reduce the overall market borrowing of the government for the entire fiscal. So this is regarding government borrowings for the coming financial year, which starts from April 2018. Then next is bonds lose their charm for overseas investors. So actually foreign investors are cutting down on their holdings in Indian bonds because it has been seen that their returns have been eroded and there is huge economic risk too. So foreign investors have sold a net of 1.12 billion in Indian bonds, Indian debt. So this is the strongest monthly outflow since December 2016. And it is also on the verge of the foreign investors turning net sellers for the year. so far. So there has, this is because even rupee has not been, you know, doing well. 2% fall in rupees was seen in 2018, and the returns of foreign investors on Indian bonds has been eroded as such. Also, other emerging markets are more favorable. US interest rates have also narrowed the yield differentials as such. So US interest rates are rising. This is also a concern. And other developing markets, emerging markets are more favorable. So another concern, India specific concern, is inflation. Inflation is also above the 4% target, which Monetary Policy Committee as such has, and RBI is expected to raise the policy rates as such. So these are also concerns that policy rates may rise in the country. Even energy prices in the country are increasing. India's trade and current account deficits are widening, and government's fiscal deficit target is being loosened. So even government would increase spending ahead of general elections. So all these have turned Indian bonds negative. So yields on Indian, returns on Indian bonds are negative 2% presently at the start of 2018. So it's the second worst performing Asian bond after Philippines. And the weak rupee has eroded returns, because of which foreign investors are now selling Indian bonds. So here you can see the foreign funds purchase of Indian debt has been shown. So over the months, you can see in the month of March, there has been huge outflow. Selling of Indian bonds by foreign investors. Then next is land decay to displace tens of millions, survey warns. So land degradation will result in mass migration of at least 50 million people by 2050 has been estimated, and it may go to as many as 700 million. If humans don't stop depleting land resources. So this is according to Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystems, which is a huge consortium of scientists from across the globe. So it is said that land degradation is taking place due to unsustainable farming, mining, pollution, and city expansion. So a huge amount of the population, 40% of global population, is said to have been affected because of this. So this is there. It says that a large amount of forests, even grasslands, have been converted. 87% of wetlands have been lost. And this land surface has changed to such an extent that the problem of land decay will result even in food security being threatened for the world's citizens. So even access to clean water would be affected. Breathable air regulation would be affected because of soil and plants which regulate it. That would be affected. So air, clean water, food security, everything would be affected. And land degradation is a huge concern which has been highlighted in this report. And the last news item is ball tampering issue. Smith banned for one match. Bancroft warned. So Australian captain Steve Smith has been given one match suspension and fine of 100% of his match fee for a ball tampering incident. So this ball tampering by the opening bowler, Australian opener as such, the Cameron Bancroft. It was seen captured on camera, and they have admitted to it as such too. So that is why they have been fined. Even the Australian opener has been fined 75% of his match fee. So this on camera tampering of ball was caught when they were playing against South Africa in Cape Town. So ICC, International Cricket Council, has given this order. So these are the news items. Thank you.